Does the benefit of quantum computing provide evidence for many worlds? Scott.
I would say that there is a philosophical argument that, for example, David Deutsch has made, right? That says that, and this was very closely related to why he invented the idea of quantum computing in the first place in the early 1980s. Right, that says, well, look, suppose that you use a quantum computer to factor a 2,000-digit number, right? You know, and Deutsch said this very explicitly, you know, in the 90s, right? Suppose you run Shor's factoring algorithm, and it factors the number, you know, just vastly more efficiently than we think it can be done with any classical algorithm. And he says, you know, if you don't believe that quantum reality is in some sense a vastly larger thing than classical reality, then where did the computation happen? You know, where was it done? Right. And so, you know, I think that does get at, you know, why quantum computing is so interesting to many of us in the first place, right? That it seems like this really, really hard to fake test that, yes, there is some kind of reality to these abstractions that we're talking about that do involve these vectors and this exponentially large space, right? But now I would say the philosophical part, the part where people can reasonably disagree with each other, is should you describe that in terms of parallel universes or not? You know, is that the right language to use for talking about this vast thing, right? The problem is that, you know, what do we mean by something being a different universe, right? Usually, you know, we mean that it is evolving independently from us, right? It is, you know, its own separate thing. I mean, in the TV shows and the movies, there's always some portal or some wormhole or for by which you can visit the other universe. Because, you know, if there weren't, then what would be the plot? Right. But somehow it is separated from our universe. OK, but the trouble is, if it's separated, then for that very reason, we don't see the evidence of it. You know, like if we do a quantum computation, then, you know, at the point when two branches, you know, are really separated, then, you know, we don't see the interference between them. We only see, you know, our branch. And to the extent that you do see the interference, you know, as you do in Shor's factoring algorithm, for example, you know, or other algorithms for quantum computers, then you could say the very fact that these things could interfere means that they never really established separate identities as parallel universes at all. They were all just part of one giant interfering quantum mechanical blob. Right. So I think that that's a philosophical objection. I do agree that, you know, a quantum computation would be dramatic evidence that, you know, the state of the universe, you know, is this vastly bigger thing in some sense than what classical physics posits for it. Right. And that is a huge deal. Now, you know, I get annoyed when, you know, people will take the latest quantum computing experiment, like what Google did, you know, with its Willow chip this past December, and they'll say, oh, you know, this is new, you know, evidence for the reality of parallel universe. It's like, no, you know, no, it's not. It's just evidence that quantum computing works, like the theory said. And, you know, if you agreed with the philosophical argument that that can only be explained by many worlds, then you should have believed that way before this experiment, right? And if you didn't believe it, then you still shouldn't believe it. So it's not like, you know, these experiments are changing things that much. But, you know, there is this philosophical argument that I think is at the heart of why we care about quantum computing, why Deutsch invented it in the first place.
Briefly, before you respond, Jacob, I want to know, well, what would David Deutsch say to your response about that the universes must be independent, so how would it manifest in this universe?
Oh, what would he say? I mean, Deutsch would say that you don't even need quantum computing to see the obvious truth of the many worlds interpretation. He would say that even the two-slit experiment, you know, from more than 100 years ago, you know, where you see interference between two paths that a photon can take. Even that clinches the case and can only be explained by, you know, the many worlds interpretation, and everyone else is just in denial about it. And then he would say, okay, but for those who are too dense to see that, you know, building a quantum computer may help them psychologically. Right. It may, you know, make it even more undeniable. But he thinks you don't even need it.
There's some very interesting history here. And Scott, I'm sure you're aware of this, but many of the people who are watching may not know. But Deutsch's development of quantum computing is really a fantastic example of how thinking philosophically and foundationally about physics in general and quantum mechanics in particular has borne tremendous fruit.
I agree.
My understanding is the story is that Wheeler had him sit down at a dinner with Hugh Everett when Hugh Everett sort of came back out of retirement in the 70s.
Yeah, I can almost see the building where that happened.
Right. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And they sat next to each other.
Uh-huh.
And at the beginning, apparently Deutsch was skeptical or whatever, but by the end of the dinner, he was quite convinced. And then just like Scott said, I mean, it's in the papers. It's kind of amazing, right? There's this foundational paper in quantum computing from 1985. It's quantum theory, the Church-Turing principle, and the universal quantum computer. And Deutsch is not shy about citing the Everett interpretation. It's like in the abstract, and throughout the paper, he's like, and this only makes sense under the Everett picture and the Everett, you know, he says very clearly that. You know, one of his motivations for developing quantum computing is to make just completely clear that the Everett approach has to be correct. What's interesting, and Scott, you mentioned this, and this is exactly on point. The sort of modern ideology that is dominant among people who think about and work on the Everett approach, and this is typified by books like David Wallace's 2012 book, The Emergent Multiverse, is that you really need decoherence, meaning the gradual disappearance of interference effects between the branches, in order for macro world branches and distinct universes to emerge. And that precisely doesn't happen in the middle of a good quantum computation.
Yes, that's what I was saying.
Right, exactly. So my point is just that, like, this is what Scott's saying is really the standard way that most Everettians think about it. So the Everett approach doesn't really help you so much with quantum computing, because those other universes, they don't exist precisely in the case when they're being used, so, you know, so to speak, for a good quantum computation. And I'll just say a couple of things about this. One is, there are a lot of situations in quantum mechanics where if you take seriously a particular philosophical perspective, at first glance, it may seem a little bit, you know, helpful, revealing. You know, quantum computers in some circumstances can do things more efficiently than we believe is possible with classical computers. And the actual existence of multiple universes seems like maybe this is what gives these systems their advantage. But then on further reflection, it gets kind of strange, because if these universes are just really there, in some sense, whether in the microscopic case where, again, there's not agreement that we should be even thinking that way, or in the macroscopic case, you might think that you can get speedups in far more circumstances, that speedups would be far more generic. As Scott has at the top of his,
yes,
his blog, right,
yes,
his tagline, if you take one,
yes,
thing away from this blog, it's that,
yes,
quantum computers don't get speedups because they're trying out all the possibilities at once. And that's very confusing, because if you think those universes are there, you might just think you can get speedups all the time. It's actually kind of amazing that you only seem to be able to get speedups in very special circumstances. And if those, so for me, this is almost evidence that we shouldn't be thinking that way. And Scott, you put this really beautifully. I forget when you said this, but you had this lovely quotation where you're like, these other universes are not quite as real as actual universes. And they're not quite as they live in some sort of, intermediate regime between being real and being not real.
Boris Carlson, who said that. But yeah, I mean, I've been, you know, banging my head against the pedagogical problem of how to explain quantum speed up for 25 years.
Right. Right.
I like to say that, like, quantum computing is a weirder resource than any science fiction writer would have had the imagination to invent. right?
Right.
It's not just classical exponential parallelism, right? But, you know, it's related. I mean, you know, in order to explain it to people, usually we say, like, yes, you can create this superposition over exponentially many possible answers, but then you get only this tiny portal for observing something about it, right? You have to make a measurement. Measurement is a destructive thing in quantum mechanics. It collapses the state. And then your only hope of getting a speed up is to exploit the way that amplitudes in quantum mechanics, being complex numbers, work differently from the probabilities that we're used to, in particular that they can interfere with each other. So with every quantum algorithm, you are trying to choreograph a pattern of interference where the contributions to the amplitude of each wrong answer are canceling each other out. They're interfering destructively, whereas the contributions to the amplitude of the right answer are all adding up. They're constructively interfering, right? So that's not a thing that is, I mean, I can say that if you give me a few minutes, right? But that's not a thing that is easy to translate into any pithy English phrase that we had beforehand.
Right, right. Well, let me just say a couple of things about this. One is the use of branching tree-like graphical structures is not unique to quantum computing.
That's
if you're
right.
teaching a course in probability theory, we draw like outcome trees, probability trees, decision trees all the time to explain things. So, I mean, I completely grant that drawing, you know, trees of branches is a pedagogically useful exercise. But so I want to then jump on the point that you made, which is that the key to quantum computing is the ability to exploit the fact that these amplitudes are complex and that the different possibilities interfere and you can use them to sort of cancel each other out. Interference is this, you know, very important property in getting quantum computing to work. So and actually, I think that's kind of key, because if you think it's all about parallel universes, you might think you get speedups all the time. When you realize that it's actually requires this very delicate use of interference, you realize the class of problems you're going to be able to get speedups for is actually not going to be totally obvious and will require a lot of careful thought.
Right. We've been working on it for 30 years.
Exactly.
Trying to figure out what exactly is that class.
Right, right.
You know,
now, but,
I kind of like the analogy between the Everett interpretation and just, you know, Darwinian evolution, where you have, you know, these populations of species that can interfere with each other, you know, namely reproduce sexually, right? But, you know, that's only when the population remains, you know, relatively close to each other in its DNA sequence, right? Once you have two isolated subpopulations that get far enough apart from each other, then they're never again going to merge. Right. Then they really have branched off into two separate branches, what, you know, biologists would call two different species, and what in quantum mechanics we would just call separate Everett branches.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a lovely metaphor and very helpful, especially pedagogically. Of course, then the question is, what is interference and how do you explain interference to students?
Yes.
If you're not, you know, and if these aren't really worlds, if they're not really macro worlds yet, because if they were well-defined macroscopic realities, they would have decohered, and then we can't do quantum computation with them. So, like, what are these things we're dealing with? And there's a kind of quietism that one practices. Let's just not talk about what they mean. Let's just draw them on paper and work with them. And I think we can do better. I mean, we don't have to do better. If the goal for somebody is just to build better and more efficient quantum algorithms, to build quantum algorithms that can do more things, I think this is probably fine. But of course, we all come into thinking about quantum theory, quantum foundations, and philosophy of physics for a variety of reasons. And I think there are definitely a lot of people who would like a more physical picture that underlies this. And this is where my approach sort of comes in. And I'm happy to say a little bit for those who may be unfamiliar with my work and how it connects with this power of quantum computing. But let me
totally on board with wanting to understand the world.
Yeah.
And not just predict the outcomes of experiments. So
right.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we can talk about how to do that.
So Jacob, before you go on explaining your new formulation, I want to hear Scott Aronson's rendition of it.
Yes.
But first, before Scott Aronson, before you speak about Jacob's theory, in order for Jacob to say yes or no to you, I want you to tell the audience then, where do you think this efficiency comes from in quantum computing? Or where does the interference occur? If it's not these many worlds, if you're not a believer in many worlds, then where do you personally, Scott, think the efficiencies come from?
I mean, a quantum speed up, you know, really, if you think about it, just means classical slowdown, right? It means that our quantum computer, it can do something that cannot be done efficiently by any classical algorithm. Right. And so what it really means is just that of all of the different ways that you might have imagined that a classical computer could efficiently simulate this quantum computation, none of them work. Right. And so by its nature, you know, there's not going to be just one explanation for that. Right. There might be a different explanation for every possible, you know, way of simulating the thing classically. Right. It's fundamental. Quantum speed up is a negative statement at its core. Right. That none of the classical approaches work. And so I think that the exponential size of quantum states, you know, when we write them down in the usual way, is part of the story. The entanglement, you know, of the qubits is part of the story. If there were an entanglement, then there would be a fast classical simulation because I could just keep track of the state of each particle separately in my classical computer. The interference is a huge part of the story because if it weren't for interference, then I could just use a classical computer with a random number generator and that would do the simulation, right? So it's really the combination of all of these elements, the, you know, exponentially large Hilbert space, as we call it, the entanglement, the interference that is ruling out all of the different ways that you could simulate this thing efficiently with a classical computer. Actually, you even need more than that. There are examples of quantum computations, for example, what we call stabilizer quantum computations that have all of those elements, and yet still they can be efficiently simulated by a classical computer for another reason, right? So if you combine all of those elements, exponentially large Hilbert space, entanglement, interference, then at least there's a chance that you're going to evade any way of simulating what you're doing efficiently using a classical computer. And I think that's really what's going on.
This was just a teaser. The full podcast is in the description. As you know, on Theories of Everything, we delve into some of the most reality-spiraling concepts from theoretical physics and consciousness to AI and emerging technologies. To stay informed in an ever-evolving landscape, I see The Economist as a wellspring of insightful analysis and in-depth reporting on the various topics we explore here and beyond. The Economist's commitment to rigorous journalism means you get a clear picture of the world's most significant developments, whether it's in scientific innovation or the shifting tectonic plates of global politics. The Economist provides comprehensive coverage that goes beyond the headlines. What sets The Economist apart is their ability to make complex issues accessible and engaging, much like we strive to do in this podcast. If you're passionate about expanding your knowledge and gaining a deeper understanding of the forces that shape our world, then I highly recommend subscribing to The Economist. It's an investment into intellectual growth, one that you won't regret. As a listener of Toe, you get a special 20% off discount. Now you can enjoy The Economist and all it has to offer for less. Head over to their website, www.economist.com/toe, T-O-E, to get started. Thanks for tuning in, and now back to our explorations of the mysteries of the universe.